this is the listing that we will show at the beginning of each class that tells you roughly what's happening. And this also is a separate part of the online thing where these lists are all put together so you can go through. We don't have an index yet for this, so have to sort of rely on the table of contents for getting back into the stuff that as you go through this. Probably be about 31 of these lectures. So each day we'll put them up on the website. And you can get a little bit of an idea where we're going because the 2015 lectures are on a separate part of the website that's easily accessed from the main one for the classical mechanics. So today we're going to try to do in a very logical way the development that leads to Lagrangian and Hamiltonian mechanics, which is the heart of this of a classical mechanics course. But we're doing it in a way that lets the quantum mechanics, some of the quantum mechanical things that are very mysterious in the quantum mechanics books, become less mysterious and give you some feeling for what the role of classical mechanics is in quantum mechanics. That's called semi-classical mechanics, and you end up doing that actually in the actual operations of physics nowadays. But what we're going to do today is just show a little bit of the geometrical logic, which is going to be throughout this course, in which we will let the sort of a ruler and compass roadmap guide us to the basic idea of, first, momentum. That will be something that is done by a and, oh my goodness, we have an avalanche here. Velcro failure. But let me have that compass while you're there. Good. Okay. That's perils of the cluttered laboratory. In any case, the basic idea is to just do the amount of thinking that goes into going from having momentum to having energy rules. In other words, I want to take that on, since it's not even really well done in any of the undergraduate mechanics things that I know of. It's just sort of assumed you pull this out of the air. What's the logic behind that? And that's what I'd like to spend some time on. So what we'll do is just consider collisions of two objects. Later on, we'll have more objects, and you've all seen this Newton's apparatus. Right now, we're just thinking about collisions between two, in this case, of different mass. These happen to be identical, but understanding what's going on in this apparatus, as it turns out, people really didn't completely understand what it takes to make this work. So there's a lot of stuff in this review that's kind of new. And the simulations are also helpful, and we'll make use of these. Anything that's underlined usually is a single click should bring it up on your browser and let you play with it. These are very sort of restricted simulations here. Not much you can change on them, but later on the whole panel of controls lets you try different cases. In any case, the situation that we're talking about today is a 60 mile per hour cell faxing 4-ton SUV ripping along the highway, and it rear ends, smashes into a 10 mile per hour 1-ton VW. Before I go any further, how many people here know what SUV stands for? You do. Do you?
Sport utility vehicle.
Yeah, that's a sports utility vehicle. Okay, they're those big things that people in suburbia think they need in order to go to the grocery store. How about this one right here? Do you know that one as well? That has Germanic origins. VW.
Volkswagen.
Volkswagen. Okay, the Volks car. This goes back to the unfortunate Hitler era, which I hope we're not entering with Mr. Trump. In any case, the little, and I'm imagining it's one ton. Actually, the ones that are out there now are more than that. But 4 tons is typical for a light SUV. And we'll talk more about that a bit later. In any case, those two are on a collision course. And here we're plotting a space-time diagram. In fact, it's a Minkowski space-time diagram. And there's a whole section in chapter one of unit one where we make a connection between Minkowski, who has the time run vertically, and the space, the distance, run horizontally. But in almost all of your applied calculus courses, UP physics being one of them, you would normally put x of t versus t, right? That's a Newtonian, let's say, Newtonian space-time diagram. A subtle difference between these two, basically a reflection around the 45-degree line, which this particular vehicle is following because we've made the scale exactly 1 minute of time for a mile of distance. We're using English units to start off here. Okay, so this is a countdown to the collision. Minus 48, minus 36, minus 24, minus 12, look out, minus 6, crash right here. Okay? So that's the thing we're going to simulate. We're going to analyze this thing more or less just with a ruler and compass. Okay? I actually only need a ruler to get started. And there are two kinds of collisions that we'll have as the extreme cases that we can work out with those geometrical tools. The first one is the totally inelastic, where they go together and crumple. And if they're well designed, like most of the vehicles are now, so that you have less injury of the occupants, the crumpling can be so complete that you make one piece of metal, and that would be totally inelastic. That's the definition of it for our use here. And then the other one, which at these speeds would never succeed, any objects we know of, which I call a kabong, but in a parking lot where you were talking later, we'll scale the thing down so the cars are just moving really slowly, then a perfectly elastic or nearly perfectly elastic collision is certainly possible. So it's these two extreme cases that we'll be treating first by geometry. Okay, I'm going to try to keep two screens going here, and to do that, to make sure that this one is up and working, I think it is. Let's see if I've got the right projector on. That's the catch here. Yes, there we go. So. We'll move this over to that one and go forward on this one. Now, normally, in, say, a high school physics, university physics, and even in an advanced physics, advanced mechanics course like this one, we'd breeze through this fairly quickly and say, hey, we all know this, but boy, that's a mistake. There's so many things that you can learn by being careful with the logic. Now, the conventional solution is you just look up the usual momentum and energy formulas, or call them axioms. We're going to call one of them an axiom. The other one is not. For momentum and energy, okay, and solve, Okay, so the key word in usual education physics is rush through the axioms and just start solving, right? Well, we want to slow that process down so that the solving part may be more pleasant. So what I claim is that we can solve this problem, figuring out both of these, quite easily with just one axiom, but it's really one and a half axioms. There's an axiom that no one talks about in these situations. It's called time reversal symmetry. And we'll bring that up in a bit here. But at least for this crunch collision, as opposed to the, that's this one right here, the crunch collision, the inelastic one, that's all you need is the momentum axiom, and then a little bit of thinking. And this one, though, requires just a little bit more. Sort of, I call it a half axiom, but it's an important one. So, axiom one is stated by this course, is all masses or masses keep their total momentum. And then this sounds like a cop-out, until it's changed by some outsider. In other words, momentum is conserved until it isn't. Okay, so the idea is, when is it and when isn't it? So we're going to have to address that a little bit. And that's where we talk about the idealizations that we do to model all of our classical mechanics. And it certainly holds in this case. Now, I'm saying here that this conventional solution, which most of the textbooks would follow, is maybe not as quick and slick as what we're going to do here. So what I'm going to show you is that you get the answer just by drawing a couple of lines. It's that simple. But in any case, you should be aware that this particular holding your momentum business occurs for both of these objects as they're cruising. And momentum being the sum of the mass of the SUV times its velocity plus the mass of the VW plus its velocity times its velocity. Okay, are neither one of these or the sum is changing as they cruise. But then something happens and the two velocities here change violently. And it's our object is to find out what they change to. And what's going on a little bit in that moment, that brief moment, where the terrible collision happens. So the idea that I'd like to make sure we understand here is the axiomatic approach to our problem. And this guy, and this is a picture that looks like it was somebody that lives now. I mean, he's got a similar hairstyle to most of the people that are walking around in this building. Looks, you know, kind of like he was out of the our century, not the 1200 to 1300 era. But this is a very famous person in the sense that he was trying to figure things out. And he's credited with something called Occam's Razor. And the idea of the Occam's Razor in Latin is this, but most of you don't take Latin anymore, and I include myself in that set. Literally, it's don't make pluralities, that is, of conjectures, without necessity. Okay? Now, what he was aiming at was a plurality of conjectures that were needed to make up the his religion. He's a Catholic. Catholic priest, father, I guess you could say, padre, and very forward-looking one, though. Now, logically, it's assume less to prove more. It's kind of a get rid of the clutter and then think clearly, or be able to think clearly. Now, if you're talking about coding, that is programming a computer, okay, this is really important. Keep it simple, make it powerful, okay? So this modern version of OCaM, and of course, the computer has sort of taken over now, doing a lot of our labor, and that's good. But sometimes you lose sight of what it takes to make a good job of that fancy piece of equipment. Now, here's what we're going to be starting with. Just look at the algebra before we make the roadmap of the algebra, which is our geometry. As the equation up there said, we're going to be having a sum of a mass and velocity of these two objects. In the initial stages, that's here, and then after one of these or the other collision, we're going to have a final velocity for the SUV and the VW. But the idea is that this is idealized. They're all coming and just staying in one dimension. We'll get into that idealization in just a little bit here. But the idea is that this is equal to that. But more than that, this thing is constant throughout the collision. That instant of change that's occurring so violently, you're still keeping constant this sum. And that's an important idea to keep with you. Anyway, the numbers that we're talking about here are a mass of 4 tons, using the old sort of English units, miles per hour, 60 for this nasty guy in his SUV that's sitting there going like this with his iPhone. And then the poor VW is in Colorado, so he's had some marijuana and feeling pretty good, just cruising along. I can't tell he's really going slowly, okay? So this is a bad situation. It's probably one that happens about every 10 minutes in the whole world. Anyway, afterwards, we're wanting to know what are the velocities of these two objects after this terrible violence change has occurred by the rear-end collision. And you should note that this particular equation is really very simple. It's a Cartesian equation if you're plotting on these XY diagrams here. And you can easily solve that thing by algebra, but I claim it's a lot better to try to do it with geometry. That is, just do a simple Cartesian line plot of what it means to keep the momentum constant from this initial point. So here's where we start the geometry, and to do this we need some straight lines. So let me lend you a couple of rulers. I forgot to do that.
You got one.
So that, okay, we're in business. I've got to get my ruler working on the graph over here. And I'm going to just be drawing a graph like this, where at the initial velocity for the SUV, I'm going to put a point somewhere on the vertical that's representing 60 miles an hour for it. And then I'll have a horizontal line intersecting that that corresponds to 10 miles an hour for the VW driver. So I'm going to go ahead and draw those. And we're going to try using our new magnetic ruler so I don't have to slip as much. But basically what I have to do is draw the VW's 10 miles an hour across the graph here as a straight line that will have a point somewhere on it. And I have to pass the 60 mile an hour point, which is right here. That corresponds to the SUV. And I use a little blue coloring there to indicate the VW. It's my first car, and it was that color, so I'm using that as my goal here. So there's the line that represents the velocity of the SUV. Okay? And that's our initial a vector of velocity. And this is, you see, this is a little unusual because almost all the vectors that you talk about for physics in the beginning are vectors of position. And this isn't a velocity space, you see. So that's a little bit different. Now the question is, where can this collision go if we're going to obey the simple Cartesian equation for conservation of momentum? Where can I be with an equation like that, you see? And the basic idea is that everywhere on that line, however fast it happens, doesn't matter, I have to have a ratio of the SUV to the VW as the slope with a minus sign on the graph of VW versus SUV, that is Y versus X. And then there's an extra constant here that corresponds to the total, that's 250, divided by the mass of VW, which is 4. So actually, I see that number as not being quite right. I should have divided by 4. I didn't finish that. But this is right here. This is the thing that counts for our graph, is minus 4 slope. So what you do, and we'll be doing this several times here in this course, I have a if you squint a little bit, you might be able to see the graph that I have already drawn very faintly behind the scenes here. But the basic idea is that I'm going to be going minus 1 and then plus 4. That is, I went minus 1 to there, and then I'm going to go up plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, plus 4. Okay, so that's going to be one of the points on my line. And then just to make it a little bit more accurate, that is more precise, I'm going to do it again. I'm going to go minus 1, and then stop there, and go plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, plus 4. So there's another point that is on this line that I'm drawing through there. And I'll go ahead and do it one more time. Minus 1 unit of this, that puts me at 45 miles an hour as far as the velocity of the SUV is concerned. And then I walk up by 4 units. For every 1 unit that the SUV loses in speed, the VW picks up 4 units, is what's really going on here. So that kind of makes a sense, in the sense I go 1, 2, 3, and 4, and draw a large dot to indicate that it's on the line that I need to draw through the initial values. So, as indicated on the graph there, the V initial value, or the initial point, I'll just call it N, IN here, is there for sure, but then we need to draw a line, and at the present time we have no reason yet to forget about points that are on this side, but I'm obviously interested on this side more so than on the other side. So I put the ruler down there and make it go through and check to see that my counting was right. Okay? So they all should be on a straight line. Okay? And I'll get the little cord out from underneath it so it's more precise. Okay? So this is the line. We're going to have a collision, and it's, I'll just tell you, it's going to go this way. It's going to go boom and stop somewhere up here, okay? Maybe up here even, okay? And obviously I've drawn this thing, so it's got to be on this graph that we're looking at right here, okay? So that's the idea. We now know to within a line where the answer is going to be. Okay, and the question is, where? Okay. All right. So far, so good. Okay, so let's do the crunch first. And the question is, what do I need to do to find that? This is where the thinking comes in. What is it that I could put on this graph to locate where I will be on this line? Now think about what the crunch is. Okay, they're going along like this, crunch, right? And they're stuck together. It's one piece of metal. Okay, one hunk of metal that weighs 5 tons, right? So what can I do on a graph to make that happen?
Velocity is the same.
Make it y equal x line, right? Make the velocities equal. Okay, so let's do that. 45 degree line right through here, and you can see the answer is where it intersects. Make sure that the chalk is lined up with the ruler, both up here and here, okay? Bingo. Now, I drew my line a little bit to the side there, but if I draw a fat point, a really fat point there, you'll not notice it, okay? Now, one of the things is and if you use this for teaching later on, one of the hardest things to get modern students to get used to is that most of the time you're really lucky to get within two figures an answer. You see two figures here, you see, is 100, right? And so to get this within 1 mile an hour, tough. Right? Now we can do better than one figure that's within 10 miles an hour, but there's a lot of room in there for the kind of error that you get when you do actual geometry, you say. So when we get two figures, we're really happy. Right? Now you pull out your calculator, or you do a computer that has really big memory, right? You go 10 to the 60th. I mean, it's almost no limit. But on a typical calculator with 13 figures, it's still an enormous precision. You see, now we're talking about numbers like the speed of light, you see, and every digit counting. And that's amazing. And that's only happened recently that we really have to worry about all those figures. Anyway, there's the answer right there. 50 miles an hour for the SUV, and 50 miles an hour for the VW, okay, which I better mark over here so I remind myself what we're doing here, okay? Go ahead and make it a little blue color scheme here. Okay, so that's neat. That is basically the next slide here. And here's the algebra with y equal x in that equation. It gives us the correct answer here of 50 miles an hour for both. Okay, now the next step is not so trivial, although it's very easy. We're after the perfectly elastic kabong collision next. I'll go ahead and bring this one up to speed. Okay. So to get that, and discuss some very important points, we do a trick. We simply take this, which is the center of momentum, that's going to be turning out as a good name for that point. In fact, if I were going to draw this point the way it will be in many of the drawings that we look at later on, I would put a circle around it and then color using, say, yellow and orange or something, the quadrants. I would make a engineer's centering symbol. Usually you'll see these, if you look inside a boat, they'll show you the center of flotation, center of gravity. Airplanes have this, it's very important for airplanes to find your center of mass. But center of momentum is, as we'll see later, related to this. And so this is a symbol that we'll use quite often to indicate a center of mass. And you see, we're going to have collisions that continue over a whole thing. There'll be little centers of momentum elsewhere for each of the different collisions that happen. So that's a symbol that we'll be using. And might as well go with the conventions. And in any case, this line right here, V of the VW equal V of SUV, is the key. And then it's the compass time. It's the time to use the compass to try to draw something. And I will put some chalk in this one and go ahead and draw that point. I think I can get it to hold pretty well with this chalk. We're trying out all this new equipment here. The usual ones that I've been using have been the old-fashioned wooden fellows, but this is at least a step into the new era. In any case, put your compass at the center of the centering symbol, put the drawing part of your compass on the end point, the initial point, and then just swing an arc.
Oh, you're still a little off.
I'm not there. Yeah, I was
end point.
A little off there. It was shielding me from seeing that point. Got to bring it up a little bit there. It's harder than you think to draw a vertical circle. In any case, this is the thing that's going to intersect the momentum line and be where this should now be. And that's right about there. Did I draw that correctly?
It looks like it shifted.
Pardon?
It visually looks skewed.
It does.
Yeah. I think you shifted about halfway through.
That could be. This thing may have moved. Let's see if, yes, it did. Let's try that again. That is more like it right there. It's sort of sagged down a little bit. But in any case, this pretty close to what the answer is. And of course, I've got the answer already drawn right here. This is, if you've done it correctly, without your compass sagging. This thing is quite loose. You can really tighten it, but it doesn't change the friction much. So it needs it's the modern one, but it needs some work. So now the question is, what happened to make this, first of all, from the crunch, and then to the what we call the Kabong collision, that's totally elastic. The idea is that the two compressed in some way to B at this point, and then if they were elastic, that is, if they didn't lose what we call energy, and that's what we're trying to derive here, they would pop back out, and maybe if it was a, you know, a nice collision that didn't waste anything, end up just as far from the center of momentum as they started. And that time reversal symmetry is something we want to deal with today. That idea is very crucial to the development of all of mechanics. Everything in mechanics is just going to be involving this sort of a relationship between momentum and something else, the something else being energy. So the idea is, can we draw that, get that, and get rid of that. Now, what I want to point out, and this is a vector diagram of the type that we're going to play with, but there's a velocity vector for the initial. There's a velocity vector for the final. It's these funny kind of vectors that are just made of components of velocity. And then there's a velocity vector for this. And the idea is that they make a parallelogram. So this is the elementary parallelogram that you run into when you're doing force diagrams, where the vectors are force. And the fact that we're doing velocity right now doesn't take anything away from that. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, find my magnetic ruler, which I put down somewhere. I couldn't have gone too fast. I'll use that one for now. The first vector is this one here, which is VIN for initial. The middle vector right here, I'll use a more brilliant color of red to make this one. And put a little bit of an arrowhead on that thing. Do the same with this one. And then, if I'd been careful with a circle, I would have wound up right here. Now, the coordinates for that, if I do it correctly, the coordinates for this final velocity are 90 and 40. The SUV gets reduced to 40, which is right there. So this is a vector that is an x coordinate for the SUV of 40, and a really scary coordinate for the VW. VW has gone from 10 miles an hour to 90 in an elastic collision. That's probably not survivable. It's possible that this one here, 50, is, but that's too much. In any case, we're talking about a vector that's going right to that point there. Okay, so that's a V final. Is called V fin, and this one right here, V in, is the one we started with. That is, for the SUV 60 and 10 for the VW component. Okay, Now, the other part of this is to show that as a parallelogram and use a little bit of a geometry that a parallelogram would have. And the way I do this is I take this vector right here. This is something we'll do quite often as we analyze these things. And it looks like this thing isn't a very good object for that, because I don't believe I can turn that around to put it on the outside. So I'm going back to the old-fashioned wooden version of compass, which slips and slides. It doesn't isn't very nice about that. But I'm going to take this vector right here, and this is sort of the limit for this thing. So I'm going to strike an arc right there, and then use that arc up here. And then I'm going to take this vector right here, the initial velocity vector, strike a little arc through there, and then where those meet, which is right about there, I've got the other side of the parallelogram. And depending on how careful you are with your geometry, it's much easier to do two-figure geometry on a horizontal piece of graph paper than it is on a board. In any case, there's the one side, there's that side of the parallelogram. And I'm not too far off, so about the width of a chalk. And then here's the other side of that parallelogram. So it's not, in this particular case, a rhombus. A rhombus would have equal size for all. It's just a parallelogram. Okay? So that's our velocity parallelogram for this collision that has as its extrema the Cabong collision that's perfectly elastic. And it's the algebra of that that we'd like to explore. But this is its roadmap. And the idea is, you see, that the total mass of the two glued together times the velocity of the center of momentum is the same momentum that we're going to have starting. That's m1, that's the here the VW, and then the SUV. I'm sorry, first the SUV and then the VW. For their velocities, now we're just calling them 1 and 2 in this algebraic abbreviation. So that's the initial. And then, as they pass through here, if they pass through here or stop there, if it's the crunch, they also have a sum of 50 and 50 in this case, but that's got to add up to this sum. And then if they manage to make it all the way up to here, the final velocity that we're denoting for the Cabong, the perfect collision, elastic collision, that all of those should be equal to this M total VCOM. So that's a key observation that makes, and it certainly is very simple right here because the two velocities happen to be equal there. Okay, so what we're going to do is work with that roadmap and the algebra that goes with it. And one of the things that comes out of this is what we call a weighted average. I get that the VCOM, that's this velocity, 50-50 in this case, is equal to a weighted average at every point, the initial point, the COM point, and the final point, and anything in between, You see, all during that collision, this momentum is miraculously being held constant. So the weighted average of this, of these two velocities is this number 50 in this case. But it's the literally weighted by the masses. Okay? Now, we're going to try to do some vector and eventually tensor notation. We're trying to set up the sort of mathematics that's useful to go well beyond elementary mechanics and into Lagrangian and Hamiltonian. The idea of making a quadratic form is really important here, so we're setting that up. Now, this is designed to be used by someone that's forgotten various notations for vectors, and one of those notations that you use in quantum mechanics is the straight line and then a bracket, half bracket. That's called a ket vector. There's also one that points the other way, but if you're doing ordinary Gibbs notation after the famous American physicist Josiah Willard Gibbs that went to Europe and learned all the fancy stuff they were doing there and brought it back and made notations that we use in almost all of our calculus and early physics books. A bold vector with maybe an arrow on top of it. I'm using that notation here. That also is designated in some places by a ket. So you may be more used to giving coordinates as just numbers in a horizontal array. Well, that horizontal array is called a row vector or bra. And in quantum mechanics, it's not used as much as the ket, but they should be both equally, and the connection between them is actually very deep and not treated very well in quantum mechanics books that exist right now. In any case, we're talking about Gibbs notation with the arrow pointing the other way when we write a row vector. And the reason for that is because the thing that we're trying to set these things up for is operations with a matrix that we are going to be using for describing momentum and eventually energy. A scalar product, that is a dot product of a vector with another one, if it's done so that it will work in quantum mechanics, the idea is that a vector can only be operated on the flat side of it. The pointed side, imagine it's a hypodermic needle with poison in it, and so you don't go near it. But you can come around and get the this side and not worry about dying. The idea is that these two of these vectors could meet each other and make a scalar product, which is the product of these two numbers plus the product of those two. And this is all shouldn't be news to you. Okay. In any case, the row vector there and the ket vector there, we could of course turn these around, but this is just the first example, and that's what I want you to see. Now, the thing that we're going to be doing a lot of as we go through the vector analysis is building a full array. If you do put these things point to point, it builds this matrix. That is, this is the outer or tensor product of these two vectors, arrows pointing at each other, making something that I guess you would call a ket bra, as opposed to a bra ket, which is what you get when you do the scalar thing. In any case, you do the same thing, you multiply numbers, but now you don't add. You do 60 times 40 to make that. You do 60 times 90 to make that. You do 10 times 40 to make that number, and 10 times 90 to make that. So we're going to be playing with those quite a bit. Not so much right now, I just wanted you to see that, to be aware that that's a very valid piece of mathematics that is quite powerful, and we'll be making use of projection operators fairly soon. Now, let's pause the mathematics for just a little bit here and go ahead and indicate what had to happen in the physics here to make all this work. And that is the SUV and the VW have to be in a very idealized situation. Number one, no background, no rolling friction, no air resistance. Number two, it's one-dimensional. 1D models of really complicated systems are what we resort to when we can't solve the more higher dimensional versions. And that's very much the case here. This simple solution really depends on this idealization. So that we've reduced this to a system that now has just two, well, dimensions is one name that you could give it. Degrees of freedom is correct for mechanics and other subjects, nomenclature. So really they only have their separate velocities, and that's all we're worrying about right now. Nothing goes off the road. Nothing rotates. Nothing vibrates. And obviously if you were able to translate in the space we live in, there would be 3 degrees of freedom for this one, 3 for that, making 6 translational degrees if these things could just move around anywhere in this three-dimensional space. That's what we deal with. This is introduced in units 1 and 2 that are, the current unit, and then one that follows. The next thing that's more complicated, and it's actually units 6 and 7 to deal with this, is if you consider also rotation. Okay, which when I draw those pictures, I am definitely doing that. We have all sorts of wonderful ways to take care of rotations. This little device that's sitting right here on the desk, which I call the quantum spinner, will be our introduction to Euler angles. Euler angles are usually hated by people that have to deal with them. This will show you how they really are quite beautiful and very simple to use, but it won't come for a while. Unit 3 will be the first time we kind of take a look at that. And then, if these objects can vibrate, if they're molecules, okay, they'll have a certain number of vibrational degrees. If it's an N-atom molecule, there'll be 3N minus the 6 that we've already talked about, degrees of freedom. So when we get to between these units, we'll be dealing with generalized curvilinear coordinates, which is certainly the rotational thing falls in that, but then there are much more complicated versions of that. So these are all things that we're forgetting now, for pretty much, as we do this very simple problem. Now let's go back to our very simple problem, because I definitely want to make Galileo have his entree and say about what's going on here. You have to realize that this momentum conservation is really a big deal. It really took a lot of thinking to put that down, so to speak. And Galileo did that. And he was inspired, I would guess, and this is something you have to imagine, he lived in different Italian seaports and saw boats moving near the wharves and moving just as people either dragged them, some of them you could do that, other big ones would be coming in, and it would be a big deal to stop them. So the idea is something that did conserve its velocity. It was unlike the carts that live on the land, and you have to keep pushing them to get them to move. The idea that something would move without being pushed, and in fact it demanded that you not push it, that's a big deal, you see. But also the idea that if you're on board one of these ships, you see, or if you're using the ship as your coordinate system in which you consider everything on the ship to be at zero velocity, then you're making use of a really important symmetry transformation that seems to exist in our space, even in the presence of gravity if you're only moving horizontally. But it really applies to all three dimensions. And the idea is that if you increase your velocity, then the rest of the world appears to be that much slower. So if I was interested in getting you guys moving, I could do it very easily. You are now moving minus 3 miles per hour, you see, relative to me. So that's the Galilean transformation. And it wasn't until around 1900, actually 1905, that another guy that has a kind of a bearded look to him, Albert Einstein, realized, you know, this doesn't work. This isn't true, you see. But the rest of the world isn't going slower, at least not most of it, and not exactly even all of it. So the idea that applies to light, this particular speed right here, you see, it doesn't matter what speed I go this way, 3 miles an hour or 300,000 miles per hour, a piece of light is still going to look to me be going that number. That's a mind blower, you see. This, we can understand, it's particularly if you draw a road map like this. The idea is I'm going to subtract 50 miles an hour from all of these points. That means I subtract 50 miles an hour here and here. For every point on this thing that we just did. Okay? Which means I bring the center of momentum point to zero. Okay? Very simple operation. This road map shows you how you make that transformation. So you have the same physics here as you do here. That is, this change here with respect to the center and this change here, same. Now we need to show a little bit more about that, and that's what comes next. So let me go ahead and just say, yeah, there's a whole bunch of different reference frames here. For example, right nearby this one is the reference frame of the VW initially. The VW wasn't going anywhere according to it, right? So there's where you would draw the collision from his viewpoint. And he's about to change, you see. He's about to get knocked to 90 miles an hour, so he won't be in that reference frame for long, right? He'll wind up, you know, up here at 80 miles an hour relative to where he was before the collision occurred, right? And then here's one, it's the viewpoint of the SUV after the collision, you see. He sees these velocities for center and the initial, that's SUV going zero after the collision. So all of these points are just of interest to this particular collision. Somebody seeing zero at some point during the collision in these. But there's a continuous infinity of possible reference frames. It's really the main idea. Okay. Now, time reversal symmetry is quite important. It plays a role in all of the physics we do. It's just that it does it behind the scenes. Everyone sort of takes it for granted. And the idea of doing a time reversal, that is, flip t to minus t, that means you have to run the movie backwards, but when you run movies backwards, all of the velocities, that is, all of the delta x, delta t, get a minus sign on them because the delta x stays the same. It's delta t that changes sign. So that means flip the velocities, and that's what's going on here. This is a particular scenario flipped is this one. This particular scenario here flipped is this one. And this particular scenario, that is the one that's right at the center of momentum for this collision, is the same. You see, it looks the same. It's invariant to this particular transformation, so China reversal transformation.
Each line represents a frame of reference.
Maybe I was pointing at the wrong thing. Actually, what I should be pointing at is that line right there. Thank you for pointing that out. That's right. There is the COM line that is invariant to this. I spoke wrong. This one is a transformation from this particular frame to that frame. But this one right here, invariant to the transformation. It would just take initial and final and switch them. Now, what that means is we're talking about, and I'll try to make this one go one-fourth the speed of this one, okay? And my nose will be the center of momentum, okay? So I'm going to come in, boom, on my nose, right? And then it's a kabong, so I'm going to spring back out again to there, right? So you look at a movie of that, and you can't tell, even if it's a crunch, right? I could go in, crunch, just sit there, right? Now I run the movie backwards, and it goes uncrunch, right? That looks crazy when it's cars, right? Take these cars that are all nice and shiny and new, and they're a waste of junk, right? And then, whang, that's crazy. You see. But that's what time reversal is. The idea, if in a parking lot, they go in and they come back out again, essentially with no damage, right? Of course, at the quantum level, big mess, right? You went in, little bits of things got pushed a little bit, right? And so, and you heard it, right? You heard sound. If you heard sound, you know there's some energy wasted. So it wasn't quite elastic. We're using a sound effect kabong, but the fact that you could hear it means it wasn't perfectly elastic. These are all minor points, but they're kind of major points when you're really talking about stuff in quantum mechanics and nuclear physics and so forth. Okay. So, as I say, you flip velocities, everything goes backwards and reverse. Okay, the CMO collision now is being highlighted. And it's very much invariant to this type of transformation. Now let's look at the vector algebra. By that I mean we're going to have a mass matrix multiplying a velocity vector and making us a vector that represents momentum. That's the big deal here. Okay. So we're just going to be doing a matrix product to make another vector. This transform of this vector by a mass matrix. And in general, we're going to be using later on mass matrices that have off-diagonal components. For now, we don't have that, but later on we will. And this is a quick lesson in Dirac notation. I mean, it's quite simple in relation to using Dirac notation there. We will later on. But the idea is that you hit those components and make a new vector. This is the Dirac notation for the matrix, and this is the thing. You can see why Dirac notation was resisted for a long time, because you have to write a lot more things if you use it than this. But it's very elegant in the sense that it shows you, it gives you kind of a roadmap, a digital roadmap of what you're doing. And we'll talk more about that later on. Right now, our momentum doesn't have a cross term. But still, we can use the notation of a matrix multiplying the velocity and giving us a new thing. It has a different unit, so why shouldn't we also let the mathematics have differences as well? And we're dealing with this 45-degree diagonal, which has equal components, and there are three ways, as we've mentioned already, involving the quantities that we've written down, to write axiom one. So we're trying to make that axiom into something that is useful. So this is just a repeat of those three vectors and their properties, geometrical properties, a roadmap of this equation. And it's going to also be true later on for things that have a full matrix here. So we need a tensor, that's what matrix really should be called here, to describe our relationships between various kinds of velocity and momentum. This is particularly true if you're talking about rotations. If you're talking about angular velocity and angular momentum, most of the time, that will not be a diagonal matrix. Most coordinate systems, it will not be diagonal. And the other thing that we need here, I think, is, and there it is with full glory, the basic idea of the equation in that notation. So this is the one of the ways of doing this that I think is worthwhile. First of all, this equation right here is the same because VCOM has equal components, you see. It's on the 45-degree line, okay? That dotted with this is the same as just multiplying by its numerical length value, its magnitude. But this right here is a m dot vn. And then the same thing is due for m dot vfin. And you can also go ahead and use the COM and forget about the extremities. You have this number as well. And of course, this one right here just boils down to m total times vcom squared. Okay. So realizing, and you see where we're going here, because I've got a thing here that's mv squared. And except for the factor 1/2, which will come out of this, that is the thing we call kinetic energy. And the question is, when is it conserved, when is it not? So we're going to use the numbers that we have, that we just worked out here, just to see how this plays out. So basically what you're doing here is just multiplying by the number 50, an operator hitting a vector. You're doing it again here with this same operator, but a different vector, the final 40-90 miles per hour after the collision. This is 60-10 before the collision. And all of these things are supposed to be equal, and indeed, they're going to be equal to the total mass, which is 5, times 50 times 50. Okay, so that comes out to 12,500 in crazy units. We're not being careful about units, but English tons and British miles per hour are, you know, kind of warm and cozy compared to the MKS system. So that's why I've picked them here. So this is a look at the vector scalar products and the sums that you get there. Same thing here. All this has to add up to 12,500. Okay, let's bring this one up to speed to just refer to it when we get the numbers that we want, and it's also the geometry that we want. Now, this is where we put in the actual symmetry. We pointed out already that the total momentum is the same all along that line, including the three points that define the line. And now we're going to use T symmetry. This is where the axiom 2 comes in, sort of a half axiom. But the idea that VCOM is halfway between the in and the fin is really crucial. That is absolutely key in order for this to be right. You see, this parallelogram has to be balanced. You have to have gotten all the way to the other side of it for this to work. So that's really what is involved in this derivation of kinetic energy conservation. Okay, so what we do is we put the VCOM as a half sum into that, and go ahead and expand this linear relation out. And we might as well go ahead and put the numerical value for that one as well. So you end up here with, first of all, a thing that is 1/2 mv squared. Now that is going to turn out to be the kinetic energy initially. And then you have this thing right here that's a lopsided quadratic form. This is a nice symmetric quadratic form. This is a lopsided one with fin on one side and in on the other. And then this one is the same deal right here. Here's a nice symmetric quadratic form involving two V fins, but this one has an in and a fin. This time the fin is on the other side. So this one's lopsided one way, this lopsided another way. But, and this is a really key thing we're going to keep running into in this class as we play with various kinds of matrices describing mass or inertia. And it turns out if the original matrix, that is the M11, 12, 21, 22, is symmetric, that means these two numbers, M12 and M21, are equal. If that happens, if JK and KJ are equal everywhere, okay, then the lopsided terms are equal. Doesn't matter whether you put the 49 on this side, 60-10 here, or vice versa, you see. Okay, they're both going to give us that number, 10,500, which will have some significance shortly. But that is really a key part of the conservation theorem. It's not an axiom anymore. We're taking its axiom status away. We can derive this. That's very important, to be able to derive something that you normally would just say, oh, we're going to state it right along with energy momentum conservation. Okay? So, what that means is that I can take that thing off just as one quantity from that product. I'm going to subtract this guy right here, leave me with this and this. Okay? That's it. That is a derivation of this conservation of kinetic energy. And check it out. That's the 10,500 that we're talking about in this this example. Now, this is a matrix version of this right there. Now, in order to get this number, see, we subtracted them. And that's something that is kind of neat. There's the actual numbers all, you know, laid out so you can see the arithmetic was done correctly. So what we're talking about is a total energy. In some units, you know what the units are if you've already gone through and study the mechanics of this thing. We're used to joules in the MKS system. Energy here of foot pounds, that's one way to say it, as opposed to Newton meters in MKS. But anyway, we've got whatever units they are, we've got a kinetic energy here of 7,250. Now, I'm going to go ahead and come up on this one so we can make some comparisons of this. That's as far as we can go, a little too far because it extends below the screen there. The thing that's going on here, when you write an equation like that with these numbers, is that you got an expression like this, and this is N or fin. They're all giving us 7,250 in the conservation case. And you can see what's happening if you do the geometry of this. And this is something that I'll ask you to do just as a short problem. And the basic idea is to take this equation here and divide by that kinetic energy. And while you're at it, divide by the inverse of the M1 and the M2 in each of those terms, so that you end up with an equation for an ellipse. That is an x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared that has the a's and the b's as parameters that are very, very important here. This parameter right here, 60.21, is the a radius, which is the, in this case, the minor radius, because the ellipse is standing on its head here. And then the other one, this one right here, 120.42, it's 120 and just a little bit, you see. And this one right here is 60, but very little bit, 0.21, you see. It's just one of those pixels. If you stand at the board there, you can see it. But notice what happens is that that 60.42 has to curve in to be this 60, you see. And of course, this one right here, well, it's got to curve all the way over here to make that 120 plus into 90. So as you go along this line here, your energy is not conserved. And in fact, what you're going to end up with, and just I'll show you this in just a minute here, you're going to end up with a smaller ellipse right here that has these radii, because here we're using the kinetic energy associated with the COM point. So the ellipse is tangent right there to that center of momentum is at a lower energy. In the meanwhile, the other energy, which went through the initial point, okay, and then deviated from the momentum line until the final point, you see, is just a little bit higher. So that's the geometry of a collision, where you really can see what's going on. Roadmap of the thing, plus the algebra that goes with it. It's the marriage of those two that are going to make a really working system for you in any subject. But mechanics is a good place to start getting that idea down. Now, we only have just a little bit of time, so I'm going to go ahead here and just sketch the things that happen. This is just a listing of what we've just talked about, and the kinetic energy in or fin, and then that extra thing. What you can do is you can turn this into a formula for how much is lost, and that's basically this thing right here. This minus the kinetic energy of COM, okay, that's this 3625 minus 2625, that's just 1,000, okay? For the elastic kabong, the 1,000 is the potential energy that you have as you pass the COM point. So if this thing is going to be able to spring back, that is, and let's just look at this diagram right here, you're going to come into this point right here, and the idea is to spring back to that point, then the energy that is somehow not available right there is waiting in the springiness of the vehicles or whatever it is that's colliding. So there's where we introduce potential energy. And other chapters, we're going to play some funny games with that. But for kinetic, we're doing a very careful job here of accounting for all of these things. This is the 1,000, the same in all frames. And that's what I mean by, if I take this picture right here and do a Galilean transformation down to here, it's really a beautiful geometry. There's the ellipse that I end up with, and it has to be tangent to the line that goes through there, you see. So that has to be tangent. We'll talk more about what's going on there. But this is that center of momentum, the very special frame where things come in and then go back out again symmetrically. It's just being done with that little ellipse there. So no matter what frame you look at, you're still talking about a deficit of 1,000 as you go past the VCOM point. That has to be invariant. Okay, these are other pictures in the textbook. If you go and read through that thing, here's what we were talking about. Here's where you end up with the COM. But you could end up somewhere else. You see, as I say, as usual in physics, opposite extremes are easier to analyze than these generic real world. This case is somewhere in between. So that's why you almost always see them describe and say, we've got to solve a quadratic equation. We've got to solve the momentum equation, which is linear, with the energy thing, which is quadratic. So that makes a quadratic equation, okay? And there are two solutions. So if you start here, you say, you could wind up, well, not quite making it back, right? You would wind up there. But there's another solution, it's right here. I call this one WUMP, this is FLUMP. And the question is, what is that? That's something I'm going to ask you to think about. Okay, what is that extra point? Now, you can read about it, but just before you look at the answer, that's one to think about. Okay, now this is how to draw ellipses, which is important if you're going to actually graph these things out carefully. But I'd like to go back and look at some of the simulations that go with this, just so you get a feeling for what's coming. This is the basic elastic collision simulation. Let's just see what happens if I do that. I'm going to do it on this. I think we'll get away with it on the small machine for this one. Let's just see what happens. I should hold down here and release, I think.
Try double clicking it.
That's weird. It doesn't seem to be picking it up. Let's go over to this one, which is probably more reliable. Go back. Let me try this one first here. There we go. So this is just a cartoon, okay, of that collision. Return to sender, which I can do very nicely on this computer. Sometimes they don't work. This one right here is a dual space thing.
square it up, true it up so we can see the other panel.
Oh yeah. Let's do the view, and I will enter full screen. There we go, yeah, and get rid of this. So this is just showing that collision in bounce it. This is the sort of the professional version of our collision cinema. There's a thing that shows all the parameters that you can change in this thing, which we'll talk about later on. But I'm going to take it back to t equals zero just to show you. Here comes the SUV, the bad SUV texting away, and there's a Volkswagen creeping along, bang, okay? And we've gone from 4 to 9, which is the numbers we worked, it's a different scale on this. Now, here's where the fun begins. Every time a thing hits the ceiling, we'll call it, the thing bounces from plus to minus. This one bounces horizontally in the SUV direction. And then when they collide, they make one of our lines of slope M1 over M2, right? But what's cool about this is with a ratio of 4 to 1, there's some extra symmetry. And this is what we need to talk about. This is where you can really analyze these collisions in a closed system. And the thing we haven't done is do the quantum mechanical version of this. That's hard. That's really hard. There are all kinds of things that you have to decide what you want to call them. But in this particular case, it's periodic. I mean, globally periodic. It's now just retracing lines. Change the ratio slightly, it's very likely that you will not, and now the thing is on the 45-degree line. They both have the same velocity, but their positions are different. And of course, we could run it faster and make it go. But you see, it just copies it. Now it's getting ready to draw a whole nother one that's conjugate to this figure. So there's a heck of a lot of extra, shall we say, phase space topology and geometry associated with it. And we're only talking about two masses in one dimension. There's all kinds of cool stuff waiting for this system. It's so simple. Such a simple system. And we're going to get Lagrangian mechanics, Hamilton, you name it, we're going to get it out of this. We drag it kicking and screaming, so to speak, from such a simple thing. Now it produces a dual system. So to make it completely periodic, you have to wait a bit longer. So those are all things that we can analyze by doing Chapter 5. Chapter 4 that are coming up here.
All the lines, they seem to be within the ellipse.
And always when they're not touching each other or the walls, you have to be on the ellipse.
No
assuming
horses.
That we don't have any of the friction turned on, we haven't turned any gravity on, or anything to push them one way or the other. Eventually, if I waited long enough with a system that isn't a nice number like 4, I would fill that solidly. That's called the ergodic case in statistical mechanics, where you access all points in phase space. It's actually really hard to do. It turns out that you have little quasi-symmetries practically everywhere in the parameter space.
So would the ergodic case have zero symmetry, have no symmetry at all?
Well, it would have, what you would be losing is the periodicity.
Right, okay.
You see, actually the ratio of 3 is completely periodic, very stupid. We'll show that later on. But 4 is quite interesting. It's not a trivial, not right now, you see, it's retracing the lines pretty well. But it's going to make some new ones if you wait long enough.
4:1 mass ratio.
Pardon?
4:1 mass ratio, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
This particular mass ratio of
4:1,
the 4-ton SUV, 1-ton Volkswagen is what we've been working with. So we've got some fun, and we're just playing with two things in one dimension. Which makes the quantum mechanics easier, but not trivial. You see, quantum mechanics is assigning the possibility to be everywhere, right? Everywhere in position, everywhere in velocity. Actually, you'd be position and momentum would be the way you work it. We can do that too. We have diagrams where you do the momentum. And then the ellipse is, horizontal. So this is letting you review the concepts, but with something that's, how can I get simpler? Have one mass? That's too simple. I can't figure out how to do it with one. Because then you have to inject yourself, you see, pushing on it. We haven't said anything about force, right? It's just what these two do together, whatever it is. So I think Oakham would be proud. Okay, I think we'll go ahead.